Welcome everyone to this fireside chat with Nutanix, Advizex, and HPE. Thank you all for joining us today. We're going to get into a lot of great content, and the goal is for you all to walk away better informed about how these solutions and organizations can help solve your business needs to achieve the highest level of success within your respective companies. Please be sure to use the Q&A function as we go through our agenda here today. We're going to go through some welcomes and intros, our panel discussions, Q&A, and then we're going to go ahead and close it out. This is going to be a very fun and interactive discussion with our panelists, so I am excited to dive in. We're going to first start by introducing the members of our panel. I'm going to start with myself. I'll be moderating today's discussion. I'm the National Program Manager with Advizex, with a focus on our consumption practice, which is largely what we will be discussing today. We've got Ron Trimble going from on your screen left to right, Senior Channel Systems Engineer with Nutanix, Mitch Brown, Enterprise Architect with Advizex, and Bruce Feldman, HPE GreenLake Cloud Partner Specialist. I'm going to pass it off to each of the gentlemen, starting with Ron, to tell a little bit more about themselves and each of the organizations that they represent. Ron?
Yeah, thanks, Amy. Appreciate that. I'm Ron Trimble with Nutanix, Senior Channel Systems Engineer. I've been with Nutanix approximately 5 years after spending two decades in the data center, where I was a cloud architect and grew up in the virtualized world. So happy to be here today, happy to speak with these gentlemen and bring you guys some good information.
Mitch?
Mitch Brown. So as Amy said, I've been an enterprise architect here at Advizex for about 11 years, although I've recently taken on a new role. So I guess my new title is Director of As a Service Engineering. So I'm tasked to drive this consumption business from an engineering standpoint in our company going forward. My background, I've been in IT for about 35 years, early starting in my career with this guy right here at Digital Equipment Corporation back in the 90s, and been through a couple of OEM transitions and been in the channel now for about 20 years.
Great, Bruce.
I'm Bruce Feldman. I'm with Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. I am a GreenLake specialist, and my role these days is to help enable folks like Advizex around our as-a-service and consumption offerings. And then Advizex is enabled and willing and able and ready to go and take the solution associated with it and provide the appropriate consumption kind of offerings for their customers. And I've just to map to what Mitch was saying, I've been around since dinosaurs roam.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. Like I said, we've got a lot of content to cover, and we want to make sure that we get into as much of it as possible. Certainly an hour is not going to be enough to cover everything, but we're going to do our best. So I'm going to start with you, Bruce, on a question, and then, of course, the rest of you chime in. What is HPE's go-to-market strategy and HPE's perspective on as-a-service and consumption? How does that align and integrate with Nutanix and Advizex?
So HPE is the edge-to-cloud company, and what we do is we take our portfolio, work with folks like Nutanix and Advizex, to help our customers in their digital transformation and data modernization strategies. We sell everything that we have in our portfolio in an as-a-service and consumption model. And folks, as I mentioned, like Nutanix and Advizex, take that, understand what their customers' needs are, understand what their strategies are, and build their offerings around our platforms. So as an example, Nutanix would take their software, integrate it with our standard server platforms, and provide a robust offering to their customers through Advizex, who would then take our combined offering with the understanding of their customer needs, and add their services and tools and ensure that their customer gets the business outcomes that they are interested in.
Right. Anybody have anything else to add to that? Let's get into.
Well, I I think this dovetails into the broader question of what we as Advizex do. You know, we kind of start at the customer perspective from understanding what their business objectives are, and then sizing the appropriate solution and bringing all the pieces together. Now, that's very traditional consultant-led architecture work that organization like Advizex has been doing since its inception 40-some years ago. What's changed now is the recognition that in a multi-cloud world, the IT questions aren't just IT questions. They're also finance, cash flow oriented. The interest today in being able to align the costs of IT with the lines of business is just exploding. And really the only way to do that today is with an as a service solution, where instead of saying, here's a big chunk of hardware and here's what it costs, we're taking it down to the question of, well, what is the unit that you're consuming? If you're consuming storage, it's gigabytes or terabytes. And the customer is able to pay a price per unit of whatever that is and align those costs to their business. And it's this focus on looking at technology. You know, when technology over time grows its capacity, right? So a storage array 10, 15 years ago was tiny compared to what we do now. Or a hyperconverged solution 10 years ago could barely do a terabyte, right? Now it's tens or hundreds of terabytes in a fairly small package. Now the costs of those things have gone up, but the reality is the cost per unit has gone down. And so this creates a perfect world for customers where they can lock in to a price per unit over a period of time, knowing that even if they grow or the technology gets more expensive as a kind of a looking at it from a traditional perspective, the unit costs of what they're paying are going to go down. So a business that can look at their line of business consumption of these technology assets and know that their IT spend is going to trend downward as a unit and scale simultaneously with their business growth. And to me, that's the holy grail of bringing IT to the business model that customers want today.
Right.
Well said.
Absolutely. And I do have a specific question for you to chime in on Nutanix. How does Nutanix go to market with their product set? And what business challenges does Nutanix offerings address and solve? And why team with HPE and Advizex? So it's kind of three questions in one, but we'll have you take it from there.
See how many doesn't get to, right? Nutanix very much goes to market with the idea of bringing a simple platform to our customers, right? First and foremost is about simplicity. Delivering a platform that is easy to use, intuitive, and gives the customers exactly what they want. The goal of Nutanix has always been to drive down operational spend, right? It's very costly to have whole teams of engineers sitting around and all working on their own little widgets, right? With Nutanix, they have this concept of build generalists, right? Where everybody knows how to do every job because every job is very simple. So Nutanix is very much about operational simplicity. The other thing that Nutanix wants to bring to the table is choice. Today, we're partnered with a great partner in HPE, who's one of our star OEM providers. But with Nutanix, you obviously have choices of other platforms, right? Whether it be hardware or the software that you use, the hypervisor that runs on top of that hardware, or even your cloud at this point. Nutanix is very much built on choice as well. We partner very well with HPE because they've worked closely with us, their engineering teams and ours, to build some purpose-built solutions, some very dedicated products and packages that our customers can take and gain that simplicity. And we think we're giving them best of breed with some of those choices, right? And finally, what Nutanix does is focuses on the data. Nutanix very much has the data point at the forefront of their mind, right? So everything we do is there to protect the data. Nobody cares at the end of the day if a piece of hardware fails or if a link to the internet drops. They just want to know, is our data protected and secure? And Nutanix does a fantastic job of keeping the eye on the ball, making sure the data is always protected and it is going to be available no matter what may happen within the environment. So with HPE and Advizex, obviously, Advizex, as Mitch already pointed out, does a great job bundling solutions, right? And really designing something so that the customer can be successful. HPE builds great, hardware platforms and the like. Nutanix builds a great software platform, but without a trusted advisor to pull that together for the customer, really take all those needs and interpret all those needs, right? Today, we're talking about consumption, right? And as Mitch was talking about a price per unit in terms of consumption, that's something they discover in working with that customer and understanding exactly what that customer needs. And he can turn around to Bruce at HPE and say, this is what we're looking to accomplish. You guys have a platform that's going to be ideal for that. We'll talk a little bit more later in this conversation about GreenLake and how GreenLake's going to meet that need specifically. But realistically, that's where we're going, with the joint solution. It takes all of us, right, to make sure that customer is successful in getting all those business outcomes they're looking for, right? It's not about just buying a piece of software, or buying a piece of hardware and, hoping for the best, right? People like Mitch come in and they act as advisors and make sure that the customer is getting exactly what they're designing for.
Yeah. And one of the reasons that we as Advizex are taking a new deep dive into this partnership, particularly with Nutanix and HPE, is, for many years, we've been able to solve a lot of these intransigent IT problems by bringing products together to solve whatever it is. Like, for example, you just start with a hypervisor. You pick a hypervisor. It's like, if all you want to do is have virtual machines, like, what does one hypervisor get you versus the other? Not a whole lot. But, would you like fries with that? Would you like micro-segmentation? Would you like introspection? Would you like automation? It's like, we can put there's lots of ways to do that. Now, sometimes we're going to look at a customer, we're going to say, you have deep experience in this technology and this technology and this technology. The cost change can be really high. And so we can leverage the knowledge installed base of the customer to make a solution. But more and more customers today, everybody knows this, more and more customers want to get out of the business of the data center. And the real challenge for them is they really want to be about their core business. They don't even want to be about IT. As little as they can, they want to do IT. And so what we're trying to do is say, how do we build these manageable infrastructure tasks or stacks that require the least amount of effort by a customer? So if a customer is a manufacturer and they make widgets, they want to be a widget company. They don't want to be an IT company as well. And what we've found about Nutanix is that unlike a lot of the other approaches to this infrastructure stack, where you start with a hypervisor and then you add a product to do this other thing and add another product to do this other thing, what Nutanix has done is said, we're putting all that in. Right. It's in the solution. Yes, it's licensed, but that's so that a customer who doesn't need that feature doesn't pay for it. But the point is, it's in there.
Yeah.
So when a customer says they woke up one day and said, gosh, I need to do micro segmentation because I need to do a better job of security in this particular framework, you install a license key and it's there. You don't have to spend 6 months planning out an implementation plan to get all this stuff going. You just turn it on and start using it.
Yeah,
and that's the simplicity that the Nutanix solution offers to our customers and offers to us to give us the ability to bring the solution to the customer quicker, to get them basically to where they need to be quicker, which improves their time to market, right? These are all the objectives that the customers are telling us they want every day.
Yeah, so I didn't mean to interrupt you, Mitch. I was going to say, Nutanix, we call that future-proofing, right? You don't think you need it today, but you might down the road. So all those features are already built in. And you said, they're just exposed with licenses later on. So.
Right. And this is probably jumping on something we'll talk about later, but Nutanix has an API-first approach. And a lot of companies will say that, but it's very true with Nutanix. So we're confident because we very much believe that automation is critical in our economy, right? The cost to an organization of having full-time employees doing low productivity, low value, repetitive tasks, that's brutal. And we as an IT industry have to do a better job at hearing from customers and helping customers understand where in their ecosystem they're really driving down their ability to execute by, we used to call it, we still do, keeping the lights on, right? The lights should just stay on, right? What do you do at home? Do you keep your lights on? you just, it's there, it's on. That's what we have to get to as an IT organization. The way we do that is through automation. And the beauty of the Nutanix solution is there is nothing that we can't do with automation in that ecosystem.
Okay. Thank you. Bruce, I'm going to go back to you for a minute. Sure. And I know you all have things to say about each of these questions, so we're going to let you all chime in. But why would a customer prefer to have a private and or hybrid cloud IT environment? What are the benefits of that?
So if you subscribe to folks like Gartner and Forrester and IDC, the industry consultants, they'll tell you that roughly 30 to 40% of the applications that were meant for the private cloud are actually in the private cloud. I'm sorry, in the public cloud. So 30 to 40% of the applications are in the public cloud, even though for a long time, everyone had a cloud first, public cloud first kind of perspective. So what that leaves is about 60 to 70% of the applications and data that are really not meant for public cloud for lots of different reasons, such as intellectual property or personally identifiable information, security, data latency, control for that matter. And so customers are struggling with how to implement an IT environment that is the best of both worlds, if you will. And that leads us to a hybrid cloud and even a private cloud kind of implementation, always in conjunction with integration to the public cloud where it makes sense. So from that perspective, lots of customers are struggling with the environment of how do I get the balance correctly? How do I make sure that I'm not incurring undue ingress and egress fees that are unpredictable? And so they've moved to a more private cloud or a cloud experience in a colo or on-prem, if that's what they choose to do, perspective or implementation expectation. And so what happens with that is folks like ourselves in conjunction with, you know, Nutanix and Advizex can put together an as-a-service consumption or subscription model that will allow them the best of both worlds so that they can engage in a hybrid cloud kind of implementation, take advantage of their multi-generational investment in IT, some of the old stuff, if you will, that they have, take advantage of the public cloud where it's appropriate, and implement their own cloud experience from a hybrid cloud and private cloud perspective. Hope that answered your question.
It did.
And the holy grail here, in a sense, is I'll put it a different way. At the end of the day, I think we have this misconception or assumption, I should say, maybe a better word, that cloud equals what we now call the public cloud. But that's a location. And cloud is really about an experience and economics. And what we are able to do is tailor both the experience and the economics to the unique needs of every customer, right? So again, if you have a customer who's got a ton of engineering expertise and they're really good at what they do, let's say they've gone the extra mile and built a lot of automation in their ecosystem to really streamline their operations. Why break that? Because you want to throw it up into a public cloud infrastructure. But maybe they want to get out of the data center. We can move them into a colo facility, and we can take these infrastructure as a service solutions from our partners. We put that all together in that colo facility, and then we can ask the question: where are the gaps? You know, what are the things that aren't being handled by that transition? And that's where Advizex can come in with our managed services. We can plug all those gaps. We can give that customer the experience that they want, and we can line it up with the financials that they need. At the end of the day, we find that generally speaking, the private cloud is cheaper per unit of consumption than public cloud. Yeah. There are some instances where that's not true, but by and large, that's true. But even for customers who are in the public cloud and go, man, this is serving me well, one of the challenges that happens to almost every customer, and if it hasn't happened to you and you're in the public cloud, it'll happen to you eventually, is someday there will be some developer who has some rogue process that they build. And you know, maybe your spend is $10,000 a month in the public cloud, and then the next month it's $300,000, and you're going, what happened, right? There's no guardrails. But what we're doing with the private cloud solutions is there's more infrastructure there than you need. So you have wiggle room to grow and flex, but there are still guardrails. You're not going to go from a $10,000 a month spend to a $300,000 a month spend. You might bump it up. Oops, we got up to $11,000 this month. Why did we do that? Well, at least you've got guardrails to help you help constrain that kind. That would be an attack on your business to have that happen accidentally. And those are some of the nuances that we can work through in developing these hybrid cloud solutions for customers.
And the other thing, not only the finance, but it's also about control, security, yes, data latency, and those types of challenges that as a company, you have to make sure that you're protected.
Right. You know? Yeah. I think you also need the flexibility, right? That gives you the option to put that workload wherever it might be best fit, yes, right? Using COVID as an example, right? When everybody went remote for what seemed like it was going to be 2 weeks, but it stretched out a little longer than that. When everybody went remote, we saw a huge spike in public cloud usage. Why? Because nobody could get to their data centers to deploy more servers. So there wasn't hardware available because factories in China were shut down. Nobody could expand their private data center. HPE GreenLake would have solved that for a lot of people. But what we saw was people going straight into the public cloud, right? But with Nutanix, we actually give users that option, right? Move that workload. Just, it's as simple as just saying, yep, I want you to run there now. Or I want to deploy in the public cloud rather than on-prem. So it's having a solution that gives you those options. Even if you don't know that that's an option you want today, you should definitely make sure you have that in the future so that you have that capability should, whether it be another global disaster should hit, or if it's something as simple as a mandate change within your organization, right? You should have those options to say, okay, that was in the public cloud. We spent way too much. We're going to bring that back. We're going to build our solution here. The mandate has changed. We want to get out of the data center business, as Mitch has pointed out. Let's move straight to the public cloud. So having a software solution that gives you options is obviously critically important.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
Well, what we see from our customer base, what they tell us, and really it's almost more what we see as we work through these problems with customers, is that the real answer is hybrid for most.
Absolutely.
Because even though there are things that are common across industry verticals, like healthcare has a lot of commonality, and manufacturing has a lot of commonality, and retail has a lot of commonality, those commonalities aren't universal in the sense that, if you're in retail, you've got to be in the public cloud, right? Right? No, it doesn't work that. But let me give you an example. Let's say you're in, I don't know, media distribution. Well, it's crazy to imagine you're going to be able to build out the number of distribution centers for electronic media all around the world. That's horrifically expensive. Why would you as an individual organization do that? But you still run corporate financials. You still run media creation. You still run all these other things that are more fit for a tightly controlled private environment,
right?
So there's an aspect to your environment that may fit very well in the public cloud. There's an aspect to your environment that might very well fit in the private cloud. Or you take retail. Retail has this lean toward public cloud because of the seasonality effect. But the hybrid cloud gives you this benefit of saying, well, what's our run rate all through the year? You put that and a little bit of buffer in your private cloud, and you have the flexibility of Nutanix to simply run workloads in the public cloud where you need to. Now you can handle that seasonality in the public cloud, and you can do cost control on your constant run rate. And that's, to me, the sweet spot that we're at.
100% correct. Hybrid is definitely the way of the future, and companies who aren't there are definitely moving towards that model.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just a reminder real quick before we get to the next question, just to use the Q&A. So if you have any questions as we're going through this, and I'm sure you do as your wheels are spinning, make sure that you throw your questions in the Q&A chat. Ron, we talked about this a little bit, but I want to get more specifically into, I don't think we can say this enough or really drill it in enough, of using some examples of workloads or customer business needs that Nutanix on GreenLake addresses. So just really thinking about some more examples is really going to resonate with our audience today to kind of simplify what those needs may be.
Sure. So specifically as it relates to GreenLake, you see lots of great opportunities wherever you have a workload that might need lots of expansion on demand, right? So I think of things like databases where you might, you know, be spinning up large copies of databases or things like that. You might need that that additional space to move into, or that extra compute power. With the GreenLake solution, I'm sure Bruce will mention all this, you know, that's all there. It's already in your environment, right? There's no need to go out and procure more hardware or go out and lease more public cloud, whatever it is. It's already there and exists in your environment. So expansion is very simple. So obviously something that is big and powerful, like a database type solution, is ideally suited. End user computing, like VDI solutions, fantastic option for something like GreenLake, right? Maybe you've absorbed another organization, or you know, you're adding more, you've gone through a hiring blitz, bringing in a lot more people, ideally, you know, suited for something like GreenLake, where you have that ability to expand on, you know, on demand, right? Exactly what the public cloud is giving you, but you're doing it on-prem, which GreenLake's going to do for you as a solution. So any type of, you know, workload where you might have that rapid expansion that maybe didn't plan for is ideally suited for GreenLake, right? But then again, also, you know, your traditional workloads where maybe you just, you know, your constant churn rate on virtual machines, right? You're adding 100 virtual machines a month or whatever it is, just using rough numbers. And well, we know what we can get on the GreenLake platform, right? So always have that capacity there to expand into, that you don't need to go through another procurement cycle with justifications and finance and everything else to say, we didn't budget this. We need to plan for, you know, we need to get this hardware on site now. How do we do that? The GreenLake solution is ideally suited for that. So really, the workloads, any workload you'd want, but particularly those that you might see expansion in the future, are ideally suited for the GreenLake. Bruce, I don't know, did you have anything else you wanted to add to that? Right.
Great job.
Thank you.
At the same time, there's the some of the unique benefits of this kind of alliance alignment of cash flow to business. So if we take a really simple example, a typical customer, or I should say a traditional approach, would be, okay, how much do we need today? And you figure out the compute you need, you figure out the storage you need. And then you go into the room in the corner and do the seance, and you have the crystal ball, and you say, how much am I going to grow every year for the next 5 years? And then you add all that stuff up and you say, I'm going to buy all of that.
Yep.
And then there's a market downturn, and 2 years in, you're not growing, and you get to the end and you realize, if I look at the unit cost of those resources, I actually spent twice what I expected to, because my actual consumption didn't line up with my crystal ball prognostications several years ago. Now, Nutanix as a technology allows us to minimize that, because it's so easy to scale the technology. If I start with, let's say I start with a 5-node cluster, add a 6th node, add a 7th, or don't, whatever it may make sense to the line of business. But here's one of the problems that you run into with the lines of business is you don't want to be the business unit that says, hey, I got this project that needs another 10 terabytes. It needs 10 terabytes. And that 10 terabytes is the thing that pushes you over that to the that next unit. And then somebody is running around, well, who's going to pay for this? Well, I only want to pay for the 10 terabytes I need, but we got to buy this one unit, whatever it is. Well, that's the sweet spot of the GreenLake solution, because now it's metered by those resources. And one of the interesting things that happens in a hyperconverged environment is everybody wants clusters that are N+1 or N+2. Mm-hmm. But what you can do with a GreenLake solution is you can size it so the N is what you're paying for on a unit basis. So now you're really aligning the units you're actually paying for with your line of business needs. And that availability is covered in your growth model. And those two buffers work together to provide a seamlessly scalable solution that never overpurchases.
Yeah, I think that's the key too, right? Is not overbuying, right? When you're doing all that, it's a capital expense up front. And like you said, on a five-year plan, maybe you're only using the first 50 to 60% of that in those first 3 years. Well, yeah. that other, 50 or 40% is sitting there unused, but you're still paying for that.
That's
which
right.
is driving up your unit costs. So again,
and that's a great segue to another point. I talked about how,
you're making all the points. So it's awesome.
We talk about aligning the financials and the experience to what the customer needs. But see, this is an interesting piece. When you talk to a public cloud provider, you're always talking OpEx. And we talk about the traditional way of getting IT assets. It's pretty much always CapEx, especially since the accounting rules changed. What was it, 2013 with the FASB standards?
Right.
When those change, now it's like all these leases. I used to be able to operationalize my leases, and now I can't do it anymore. Well, the beautiful thing about GreenLake is we can actually deliver this in such a way that the finances can be treated as either CapEx or OpEx for the private cloud portion. And what that means is your finance organization can now separate the question of the technology purchase and the consumption needs of the lines of business from the question of where do I need this to show up on my balance sheet? Is your organization focused on consistent EBITDA? Well, we can do that by having all these payments done as CapEx. If you really need to maximize the return on invested capital for your organization, we can treat it as OpEx. Just however your finance organization needs that to align, we can tailor to that in ways that we never could before with our traditional acquisition mechanisms.
And what I would add to that is it's sold as a service, but it can be capital or operating accounting treatment. And the pricing for it is committed for the term of the contract, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. And in many cases, as you grow, the pricing goes down.
That's right.
So it's predictable. It's in your control. You get all the wonderful things about having it on-prem and owning it and being responsible for it. And then you get the benefits of our three organizations managing it, making sure that it stays up and running, and you have a solid foundation.
Well, they don't own it, because if we tell them they own it, it becomes CapEx.
Yeah, in control, I
suppose. Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Hands-on control, right. Amy.
Yeah, thank you all. We've already kind of touched on this, but I do want to dive in a little bit more about the customer transformation, how the solution really allows for customer transformation and flexibility. I know that we've talked about it, but talk about how this really allows you, let's say over 3 to 5 years, the flexibility and the ability to go up and down. What if you provision for a certain amount and you go over? What happens then, and how do we solve for that?
So I want to answer that in two ways. So first of all, what happens is we simply execute a change order on the contract underneath, right? So we go back. Let's say it's a Nutanix solution and you've grown to the point where not that you've overrun, but you've overrun your buffer level comfort. You're in that flex zone and you're just getting too close. Maybe you're getting to the point where, oh boy, if I actually lose a node, now I'm going to be constrained in a way I don't want to be. So we want to expand a little. We then go back to the contract and we do a change order, and then the equipment gets ordered, everything gets stood up and installed, and everything moves on. As Bruce said, the pricing is done by unit, right? So whether it's a storage unit or often in a virtual machine context, it's billed by the RAM that is allocated to the virtual machines. That price per unit is either staying the same or it goes down. So if you grow enough, they have a concept called banding, where once you use a certain amount, the price will go down. And that price, that new price, actually extends back to all of the infrastructure that's on the floor. You actually can get into this weird dynamic where you can actually say, I want to go ahead and grow now because it will push me into the new band that will actually save me money overall. It's kind of weird. But the other piece of that is what we as Advizex are trying to bring to the table. And that is the ability to go to a customer and respond to a need differently. So the typical way is we do the consultative process and we figure out what the customer needs and we put the solution together, we deliver it as a service, and we have managed services to do whatever pieces that customer wants to not have to do themselves. Mm-hmm. What we'd like to bring to customers, you brought up VDI, right? So one of the things that we were able to deliver this solution with GreenLake for the expansion of VDI during COVID. But what we really want to be able to do is say, well, you can come to Advizex and order VDI as a service. So we can have a rate chart that says, how many users do you have? What's the workload profile? Oh, here's your price per user.
Right.
We can deliver that straight. That's our goal, is to be able to deliver that straight out the box, if you will, the Advizex box. And that would be a fully managed solution. So all the customer has to do is give us their golden image, define the parameters, and we roll it all out for them, and they pay a fixed price per user, right? That's the conjunction of those two things. That's how the growth happens. But if we're doing it with the Advizex service model, you're really just using it. And we would handle all of that on the background for you so that the customer really wouldn't really be terribly much engaged in that process of growth. Again, driving more and more toward the experience that they would have in a public cloud environment while giving them the flexibility, the guardrails, and the pricing value of the private cloud.
Yeah. I also think it's very important to come back to one of your opening statements around Advizex, and that is that you work with customers to really understand what their business needs are now and in the future. And so from a transformational perspective, you take that business context and then apply it into the IT organization to exactly what you were just saying.
Yeah.
So I think it's important to make sure that it's you guys take a broader, more umbrella approach to the business as opposed to point solutions per se.
Solving business problems, not just providing the one solution.
Yeah, that's the key. We can bring together whatever technologies we need to, but the goal is to solve the problem. And of course, we have to identify the problem correctly.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Bruce, do you want to touch on a little bit, since we're talking about that, the trigger warnings and the visibility of knowing when we see certain things coming in GreenLake Central and being able to identify for the customer when they're reaching to that point?
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things that we haven't talked about yet, we did originally, we mentioned cloud experience, right? So part of the cloud experience is to have a platform in such a fashion that you're able to view what it is you have going on to a point where, whether it's in the cloud or not in the cloud, so from a multi-generational IT perspective, all your different pieces and parts that make up your IT infrastructure, as well as a public or private cloud, hybrid cloud kind of environment. So we have this thing called GreenLake Central. It sits on our GreenLake platform that enables customers to look at what anything as basic as what their consumption is and who's using what, based on what Mitch was referring to earlier as the unit of consumption and how it's enabled in the GreenLake environment. You can look at your consumption, and that'll also help you understand what your predictable costs are going to be. But the other thing that's really cool about GreenLake Central is it can be set up on a persona basis, such that your legal people, if you have the compliance option on it, can look at compliancy. Your CFO can look at the finances of the costs and the projected costs based on previous experience or previous production. Your applications people can look and see who's spinning up VMs or who's using the gigabytes or terabytes of data. And so all these things together allow you a real-time look into your environment. There's also modules on the platform that will allow you to go out and see where your public cloud is and what it's doing, and as well as your networking components and other areas of your organization that aren't in the GreenLake contract, let's say. So the nice thing about it is it's a single logon, gives you that cloud experience in and around your environment, GreenLake or not, public or private or hybrid. And it gives you a lot of control and a lot of visibility. It also lets our friends at Advizex help you out from a managed services perspective, because they, with your approval, have the similar look into the environment as well, so that they can help you manage the environment where appropriate.
Yeah. So, you know, as in my 30 plus 35 plus years in this industry, boy, I can go back to my earliest days as a consultant for Digital Equipment Corporation. I remember working with customers who said, I need to be able to do show back and charge back. Right. And how many of those projects were ultimately successful? Very, very few. Now I'm convinced that there's a reason. And the reason is that the day-to-day needs of the operations of everybody's business is always going to end up being a higher priority in the moment than whatever the tooling is you have for introspection to generate chargeback. But here's the nifty thing about public and private cloud. In order for us to deliver this public and private cloud experience, we have to be billing by the unit. And that is the foundation of chargeback and showback. So this objective that's been around forever in IT is kind of automatically fixed through the GreenLake Central portal, for example. But anytime we're delivering these types of services that are unit-based measures, they're providing the customer what they've been asking for literally for decades, just out of the box.
Thank you. So we've been throwing around as a service a lot in this conversation. So I want to kind of dig deeper into why there's so much interest in the industry for as a service solutions and what that really means. Bruce, do you want to start?
Sure. So we've talked a little bit around the edges of this already, but you know, most customers will procure for a period of time. I think Mitch was mentioning, you know, buying it all up front for 5 years and that kind of approach. And the reason that they do that is because they don't know what their growth is going to be. They want to make sure they don't have to go back to the well. There's all these different reasons, you know, how they work their programmatically, how they work their purchasing, you know, all these reasons are valid reasons to do it. Well, the cool thing about the way we implement as a service and consumption is you buy what you need for today. And the pricing, though, is for the length of the contract, 3 or 4 or 5 years, as I mentioned before. And it's billed to you in an as a service motion in that it is a monthly service bill that is comes through Advizex. And you're able to predict and based on your consumption, your minimum commitments, you're able to predict what your cost structure is going to be for that period of time. But it also, what we do is we actually put a layer on top of that we call the variable, where we actually put more on site than what you currently need. And it gives you a buffer that we talked about that you can grow in and ebb and flow in and out of it. And this allows you cool things like, you know, not that COVID was cool, but when COVID came about, Advizex had a number of customers that didn't need to do anything because they were in a GreenLake contract and they reached into their variable to meet their needs of all their people going home in a VDI situation, those kind of things. Well, it's positioned as a service because HPE maintains ownership of the gear. It's sold in a service contract mode on a monthly basis for the period of time. It's billed in a service construct of a monthly bill year over year. And the whole idea is to envelope it with the appropriate managed services and the services available from Advizex to fill the gaps, as you mentioned before, so that a customer can experience an outcome in a service kind of mode. How'd I do it? Is that okay?
Yeah, I mean, that's the fundamentals, but I think I want to flip that part of the conversation to the customer, the real customer problem, right? So we started talking about how Advizex in our consultative-led approach is our first goal is to really find out what the customer problem is. Now, I have to admit, sometimes we have to probe a little more deeply than expected, because sometimes a customer will say, well, here's our problem. And we listen for certain concepts, because often there's a a problem behind there. If you've ever read the book Question Behind the Question, it gives you the inkling that someone will express, here's a problem, here's a pain point, but it's really not the problem. And I think the question about why the industry is interested in as a service is actually deeper than the real flexibility that these solutions provide. And I think it goes to the question of productivity, and in particular, efficient productivity, or maybe targeted productivity. So Thomas Sowell, in his book Basic Economics, has this quote that I love, and I butcher it every time, so this is a paraphrase of it. But he says that in highly developed economies, the cost of labor will always be high because productivity is likewise high, whereas in lower developed countries or economies, the cost of labor will be relatively inexpensive because productivity is low. Well, if we think about what as a service does for a customer on the productivity perspective, it says, well, what are you wasting your expert cycles on? And a person at a customer, an employee, is maybe an expert at two things. One, their domain, and two, how that domain relates to the line of business of the company they work for. Now, we can be an expert in IT. We will never be an expert in the line of business of that unique company. Right? So when we deliver as a service solutions that take those low value, low productivity, repetitive tasks away from that customer employee, now that employee can spend more of their high productivity time on the actual needs of their unique business. And that's the sweet spot that addresses the core, I believe, customer problem that drives toward as a service solutions.
Yeah, I think that's good. As I mentioned in my introduction, right, I spent more than two decades working in a data center, right, where I was an admin. And, you know, often we're given tasks to do, but they didn't line up with where the business wanted to go, right? I was given, you know, oh, you need to provision these databases, you know, set up these virtual machines, things like that. I spent a lot of time doing tasks like that, repetitive, not didn't add a lot of value, when the business itself was giving me other objectives that would have produced value. And I could never get to that second set of objectives because the day-to-day was just so great. So like what these guys are saying is, you know, the as a service model very much takes away all of that from you, right? It says that we're going to manage all of that day-to-day stuff for you and allow you to focus on your business drivers. Where do you want to go? What do you want to get to? And ultimately, it's all about making the company money and being productive with the time you have.
Great. One more question before we get to Q&A. I'm going to start with Mitch, but I think it's important for you each to chime in on this. Why should somebody come directly to Advizex to work with each of you and your organizations versus going straight to you, Bruce, at HPE, and then finishing with you, and then going to you, Ron, at Nutanix? What is the benefit of using Advizex? Actually, any one of you can start.
Well, I'll go ahead and start. I believe that Advizex has two key principles that we have as part of our corporate culture that help us to stand out versus our competitors in the channel. One is that we are consultative led, right? So we really want to understand the customer problem and do ideation properly about what the best solution is for that customer. But the other part is we have a vision for what we call customers for life. Our objective isn't just to get a sale. Our objective is to create a long-lasting relationship with a customer that benefits them and benefits us. To return to the kind of the classic economics question, is that real economic growth occurs whenever you have a transaction between two individuals or two organizations where both benefit. It's kind of like magic. When both benefit, that's how economic growth occurs. If only one gains a benefit, you actually have an economic traction in theory. So that's what our goal is, to build those long-lasting relationships with customers and to do that in such a way that we are driving toward the long-term success of our customers, because that in turn makes us successful. It's the union of those two things. And that provides us the starting point to bring these partners in. Now, the other thing that's happening in the background is many of what we call the OEMs in the world, right? Original equipment manufacturer, but original software manufacturer, sure. I guess we'll call you Nutanix. But you guys are becoming more and more channel focused because you understand that in order to deliver really value, you have to keep your eye on your core business,
yep.
developing the technology that undergirds all this. But you can't be both a massive worldwide sales organization and do that super effectively. So you have to lean into the channel to do that. Both of you would, I think, agree with that. And it's the marriage of that. So you benefit, we benefit, our customers benefit, and we have economic growth. And the whole system kind of works out. But what that means is that the HPEs and the Nutanixes of the world aren't going to have enough people to address all of the customers out there with the kind of capabilities that we can as a focused consultative-led provider that can drive these solutions to meet the customer's actual, not just felt business needs. Yeah.
Thanks, Mitch.
Yeah. I think what I would tell you is it's very interesting. Customers today really want someone to aggregate and put together and have a general contractor kind of environment. They don't have the wherewithal. They don't have the people. They don't have the time to negotiate all the different contracts, to negotiate between multiple parties. And what Advizex, as a value-added reseller, is a long-time platinum partner of ours. And Nutanix, together, we're better together. So that Advizex is able to be that general contractor, if you will, the aggregator, to pick and choose all the different pieces that are necessary to integrate together to provide the customer with what they need based on the inspection of the customer and understanding the customer and what their needs are so that they get the business outcome that benefits them. And the other thing I'll tell you is in working with Advizex for many years, it's always about what's the right thing to do. And it's about what's the right thing to do so that all the parties are in a good place. And that's what Mitch was just talking about. So whether you're working with the engineers at Advizex, whether you're working with their middle or their executive management, it's what's the right thing to do. And that's one of the reasons why I love working with you guys. So yes.
I'm just going to say something very similar to what Bruce just said, right? You know, Nutanix and HP both have fantastic solutions, and we could certainly share those with the customer. But what Mitch went to at the very beginning is the expertise that they bring to the table, right? Bruce just touched on it as well. By picking and choosing the best of breed technologies and pulling those together and really analyzing those business solutions, Advizex as a partner has the, I think you've learned during this meeting, very smart gentleman sitting here to my left, right? Has the knowledge to pull that all together and to bring a cohesive solution to the table that's going to work, right? And ultimately, that's what everybody wants. Nobody wants to invest in a solution. They're like, it does a little bit of what I want. They want a solution that's going to meet their absolute needs. Mitch can obviously, you know, choose from those solutions, and we're thrilled that he's brought HP and Nutanix to the table today to discuss this with everybody. So,
great. We do have time probably for one question before we get to closing. Any other questions that we have, we'll be sure to get back to you. There's a question surrounding AI. AI is a big buzzword today. Tell us about how these solutions could really help solve for any AI needs that companies have that are facing right now.
That's a really big question. that's a whole nother webinar, right? So AI itself as a topic is a kind of a generalization that has a lot of kind of subsets. And depending upon what a customer needs, it's going to kind of funnel into one of those. But if I kind of generalize the business problem that leads to an AI solution, it's really a question of, I've got a lot of information sources in my organization. I've got a lot of data. I need to convert that data into information, and then I need to take that information and I need to be able to ask questions of it that a team of people in a room reading papers can't do, right? We've got to be able to ask these questions and get the answers quickly on a massive scale data set to provide us accuracy. Gaining insights from the historical data of an organization is kind of like a gold mine, right? If you think about the hourly rates of specialists in an organization, whether it's, let's say it's a healthcare organization, the hourly pay of a specialist surgeon is pretty high. An IT organization doesn't go to that specialist and say, hey, I need you to spend an hour today telling me what data I can delete from 10 years ago. There's no value to that discussion. That surgeon will look at you cross-eyed and say, go get a life. So organizations get stuck with this conundrum of, is I cannot understand what data I can safely get rid of. So the better question today is, how can I derive value from that data set? And this is one of the big promises of AI, is that by bringing that data together and analyzing it, using the AI modeling technologies, I may be able to find insights and sources of new combined information that allow me to do new things with the business that actually create value out of that stuff that maybe a year ago I wished I could delete. But getting there is a process that requires a playground. It requires a lot of data, requires a lot of high speed. And these are rather unique combinations that can be satisfied in the public cloud, can be satisfied in the private cloud. And the reality is, when you're doing the playground work, the public cloud is probably the best place for it, because it's, hey, guy has an idea, you put the data set together, you test it, you do some training back and forth. It's very variable. It's all over the place. So you don't want to commit a massive amount of resources to that. But then once you find that question, oh, if I ask this question in this way of this data set, I get something incredibly actionable. Now you're going to go into production. And when you go into production with AI workloads, pretty much you can take it to the bank. It's not going to be that small. And so you want to optimize those costs. And we find that we can do that for our customers most effectively in the private cloud. Now, this is where something that HPE has done is really superb, is they've built out an ecosystem for AI and machine learning that is in the GreenLake family or portfolio, where a customer can have a playground and in a fairly structured set of technologies that once they move to that actionable piece, they can essentially pull a trigger on a GreenLake contract, and it goes from a playground in a common environment that's shared by many tenants over to, here's your equipment that you need for your run state. It's all effectively yours in terms of your ability to control it and have hands on, but it didn't change. It's the same technologies, it's the same stack. The finance model just moved to a more optimized one. And this is something that we can bring to bear because we have our own AI technologists that can bring the value to the conversation with the customer to help determine, where can we find value in your data? What are the questions you want to ask? How are the potential methods that we can use with AI technologies to reach those conclusions, right? So we can be on the forefront of helping the customer get to that point and provide resources and solutions to them as they go to production on them.
Right, thank you. We're gonna have to queue up a whole AI separate conversation here, but thank you. We do have to, unfortunately, bring this to an end. This has been some great content. We wanna pull up, yeah. So just first of all, I wanna say thank you to everyone for joining us today. We know your time is very valuable. So the fact that you chose to spend some time with us today is greatly appreciated. All of you who have attended will get a Patagonia vest for all attendees. So after this event, a member of our Advizex team will be reaching out to you for sizing information. As you've heard, Advizex works very closely with HPE and Nutanix partners to provide customized solutions for you all. We encourage you to reach out to us directly so that our experienced team can do a needs assessment with your organization and help identify, along with our partners, the solutions that you need based on your goals so that you're you can focus on business critical objectives. So again, thank you. And a huge thank you to our panelists. It was a great discussion today. You're all very talented. We're excited and happy to have had you on. And for anybody who didn't get your questions answered, please reach out to us and we're happy to help. Thank you, everyone, and have a great day.
Thanks, everyone. Take care. Thank you.